My name is Alessandro Chantham McDonald. I was born in Gallatin, Tennessee, but I am originally from Carthage, Tennessee, down the road from here in Nashville. I attended church regularly, and I was an acolyte at the Methodist Church in Carthage, and they talked me into being in the children's choir. And I started in the children's choir when I was about 5 or 6, and I've been singing and playing ever since. I am the trumpet player in the band, or I guess horn player. At times I play different instruments, but not on this record, but some of our live shows I do play trombone and things, but I am the horn player. Trumpet, trombone, whatever we choose for me to play. As a lot of people can probably tell, my biggest influence my biggest influence on trumpet is probably Doc Severinsen. And, you know, getting to, you know, rub elbows with him and being able to meet him when I was at University of Tennessee really inspired me to kind of chase after a project like this. But, you know, my inspirations mostly are like, you know, Louis Armstrong and Bud Herseth of the Chicago Symphony and, you know, Phil Smith of the New York Philharmonic. And I have a wide variety of trumpet players that I aspired in my youth to be like, just because they had the sound that I wanted to have. But you know, as I got older, I started chasing my own sound, because you know, so many trumpet players grow up trying to be and emulate other people, and I've done that, you know. But as I've gotten older, I think my greatest inspiration has been people that don't play my instrument, like Serge Tankian from System of a Down, or, you know, Rhodey Walker from Protest the Hero, or people like that have been a pretty big inspiration to me. I mean, because they've helped me. I mean, like, just listening to those, you know, vocalists and listening to people of their caliber has helped me write music for this project. My approach is very classical. A lot of people think I am, but I'm not a jazz player. I can improv, but I don't improv the way that a jazz player would. When I write a melody and when I'm writing horn parts for the band, I try my best to think of a melody first. That's my ultimate goal, is to make a melody that no one will forget. And I've always been that way, but I write very orchestrally, or I try to. And so I pull from different styles of, like, from orchestra to mariachi to salsa to, you know, funk, rock, you know, punk. I try to pull from ska a lot of the time too, which is, I think a lot of people have labeled us as a ska band. I don't really consider us that, but I do hear what they mean by when they say that we have a ska influence. It comes from me, because I grew up, you know, listening to bands like Real Big Fish and the Boss Tones and the Skatalites and people like that. Well, in 2013, I moved back here. I had a daughter, and I had to quit my music career for a while. And you know, it was really a matter of just being burnt out from what I was doing. You know, growing up playing classical music from the time you're like 5 all the way to like, you know, 25-ish will really do a lot of wear and tear on your mind. And so, you know, while I was on my little break of, you know, having a newborn and getting used to being a father, I pretty much fell in love with the music of like Snarky Puppy and people like that. And I just really just thought, you know, it would be cool to have a project like that, in a way, this rock project, but put a flip on it and maybe do a ska thing. And then that's when I kind of reached out to a lot of, you know, put my feelers out for a lot of different projects. And that's when I ran into Lee and everybody else. And we all met up, had a couple of writing sessions here and there, probably around the end of 2014, 2015-ish. And we just started writing, and it became something that was really, that I felt passionate about, and yeah, here I am today. Dead White for me was basically kind of a rebellion against what trumpet players around the world feel is normal. I'm not a trumpet player that people run across on a regular basis. I'm not someone who, you know, that grew up aspiring to be a part of an orchestra or a jazz band or whatever. I wanted to always be me. And at times, growing up in the music industry, you know, going to college, getting my master's degree and my bachelor's, I ran across a lot of people that did not like me because of the way I play, because I play so much different than everybody else does. And so Dead Watt is kind of my, I guess, my revenge, so to speak, against people who feel like I should be one way. And this is my way of being different and not sticking to, you know, the status quo. The other guys hold the same ideals that I do when it comes to music, because music, first of all, should be something that is fun and inspirational to everyone listening and everyone involved. Everyone holds the same ideas and the same mentality that I do, I feel like, more than anybody I've played in a group with. And it's just because of the fact that they're not the status quo either. They like being different, and that's what this project, that's what Dead Watt's about. It's about being different and being unique, and but most importantly, it's about being who you are and not apologizing for it. And that's pretty much what this project's about. I see Dead Watt being breaking the barrier between genres. I'm, you know, a lot of us in the band feel like genres really hinder people from their true potential. I see Dead Watt being a genre breaker. And in a couple of years, I hope that people listen to Dead Watt and say, I don't know what genre they are, but I don't care, because they're that great and they're that awesome that we love them anyway. So I guess in a couple of years, I see Dead Watt being a force for good, deleting all these genres that people have, you know, post-hardcore and rock and emo. We're looking to eliminate, that's our goal, is to eliminate genres and eliminate that mentality. So I see us doing that in a couple of years.